favor?
Gotcha.
Yes.
In favor?
Yes. Yeah. Sorry.
Yes, for me. All opposed? Agenda is approved. Has everyone had a chance to read the minutes from last meeting?
Yes.
I'll entertain a motion to approve the minutes.
I make a motion to approve.
I second.
Have a motion to approve the minutes. All in favor?
Yes.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Minutes are approved. Any public comment? Doesn't seem like we have any public comment this morning. We'll move on. Next is the discussion of our flow chart.
Did the staff do another one for us?
I have what is reportedly the latest version.
That's from the police department.
That's the police department. This is the latest version I was sent.
Okay.
Did you get the rectangular one and
the
circular
one?
One?
Yes.
I didn't get that.
I'll go up and get it.
You want one? Okay.
I'll go.
Do you have it?
Can you ask Amanda to print your last two flow charts?
Thank
you.
I just have the police department.
Okay.
The circular one was kind of my idea, just thinking about it in the abstract, because when you're looking at these transactions, they are kind of circular as opposed to linear in my mind. So I was just sitting with her saying, you know, this seems kind of like it's a circular. So I wonder if we could do a circular flowchart.
I see what you're saying.
She came up with.
Yeah, I see what you're saying. I don't think the circular one allows for some of the cross. I mean, the thought process is kind of circular, but there are a number of offshoots that I don't think this really quite covers.
Yeah, no, it would be hard to make it match to this one, which is what we're trying to do.
Right.
It would be hard to intersect these two.
Mm-hmm.
To show the intersection between them. I think it would work better if it was linear.
Yeah. And I think we're getting closer.
I think you're right that logic does make sense,
yeah,
but only in a vacuum.
Right.
I live in a vacuum.
That is known as our thought process.
Do not.
So I have comments on the latest version. First of all, please express my thanks to the staff for trying to put our madness into pen and paper, because I realize this is a very frustrating situation.
But we're making progress.
Yeah, no, I agree.
We are making progress, and this is more progress than we've made on this issue from
the
beginning.
Well, and part of the problem is that our process is evolving parallel to the chart, you know, so it's kind of like, if we knew what we wanted, we could probably get it down on paper.
I will pass that along.
But we appreciate their
Amanda and certainly to Diane, because I certainly appreciate her input.
Their patience has been good
for this.
Well, should we talk about the APD one since we all have that?
Yeah. Does anybody need a copy? Do you need a copy? Because I have an extra one.
Oh, thanks. I have pulled it out and I left it right on my desk.
So I looked at this, and it seems pretty straightforward. The only question I had was on day 90, they have the investigators going to investigate, type the interviews, put the case together, and then send to the CPOA for findings.
Right.
Now, I was under the impression that IA complaints or IA handled investigations went through the chain of command.
Well, this must be officer-involved shootings and severe use of force. It's the only reason they would intersect with us.
Do you see what I'm saying, though?
Right. This could actually cover three scenarios. This could cover an officer-involved shooting.
Mm-hmm.
It could involve a serious use of force.
Or a criminal.
Or it could involve a complaint that has a criminal element to it.
That came from us in the first place.
That either came from us or they investigated, and there are some administrative issues as well. But they will, an example of that is the 184-15 case that's in
the Freeman
four-year review, Schaller.
Okay.
That was a case that was completely investigated by Internal Affairs. Yet, I still review it and then do a findings letter for you. The board to approve based upon their investigation.
Okay, that's too confusing for the public to understand. This whole thing is, the fact that there are different cases in which we're engaged, there needs to be a way to do that. That is, does not look like it's every case, because it's not every case.
Well, here's what I would recommend, because one of the things I'm going to recommend about this flowchart is that we simplify this a little bit. But I think we should show the path when the complaint comes from IA and the path when it comes from CPOA, and just call them kind of generic paths, so that we're not trying to explain when an investigation goes through IA and when it goes through us, because mm-hmm. that is the confusing part. Mm-hmm. So I think if we can just say IA investigates the case this, CPOA does it this, and then try and overlap them, it's, in my opinion, it's pretty close to being the same thing. It's just two paths that intersect in the middle.
Originates? I don't think so. Because there are two different rivers, and they have tributaries that cross over, but not whole paths.
I don't think they cross over. I think they come together, because the process is basically the same, whether we do it or whether they do it. And at some point, they join into the same piece right here. So basically,
showing the distinctions is important, because otherwise it looks like the police department's doing all of it, and then we're under the auspices of them, which I don't agree with. So,
well, one of the things that I want to talk about with the chart we produced was, I don't want to put in this first bar, I don't want to put citizen complaints, officer involved shootings, serious use of force, because that's not how it happens. Basically, we get citizen complaints, and that alone should go into this arrow to the CPOA. This piece here should be shown separate as going to APD. Mm-hmm. And that kind of differentiates.
It does. I'd like a chance to take a shot at this.
Okay.
And bring it back to us.
Okay.
You know, send it out to us ahead of time. Because I need to see it. I'm a visual learner, and
that's
I
fine.
Need to play with it. I'm not going to get it. I'm going to try to put both things together, and
okay.
then I'll send it out to you after this meeting.
Okay. All right. So we'll just.
Let's see where it's going.
I'll give you my circle one.
Did you?
Yeah.
So we certainly need
can I get a circle one?
Differentiate
there's
that.
There's one there. That's
ours. Oh. Here, there's another. There's your circle one.
I got one. Thanks.
And so then this essentially.
I think it has to convert it then.
Maybe if we took officer-involved shooting, serious use of force, and then criminal allegations, this box here. Moved it up, and then had that as a flow, and instead of it being Albuquerque Police Department, having it be Internal Affairs.
And that was one of my suggestions. Agreed. Now, I wouldn't move this criminal allegation box, because that's still true.
That's true. That is right, because they can flow through
absolutely,
CPOA.
Absolutely,
right.
And I think that piece is important. So, what you just described, otherwise, the three scenarios should be a separate box going to what's now being called IA.
Okay.
That was one of my suggestions, actually. Now, the other point I'll make is that the arrow from executive director proposes findings and discipline, there's an arrow that goes to the chain of command. We decided last meeting to stop
to do
doing
that.
So that arrow needs to go away.
This one.
Exactly. No. This one.
No, that's.
No, this is the higher.
That's.
Oh no, you're right.
That is.
Oh, see, you've got an arrow. I don't.
I don't. Yeah, this one's different from yours.
Okay.
Okay.
So anyway, from the ED to the chain of command arrow needs to go away.
Yeah, this needs to go away.
No.
Yes.
Yeah. Yes.
No.
Because it doesn't go to the chain of command until we have the POP
for
it.
Right. This is more accurate than what I have.
Okay. Because what I'm
sorry.
Looking at,
what we're I'm looking at different.
Okay. Because what I'm looking at is essentially Internal Affairs will then send it to.
They're all different.
We'll send it to the executive director, which will then take it to the PLB for discussion and vote.
Oh, he's got it going this way. That's why he's saying that.
Yeah, okay, so this is right.
This flows this way, and then this flows to the chain of command.
That's correct. Okay. That's right. Mine's really off.
Okay.
So that arrow that I wanted to go away has gone away.
Okay. So maybe Amanda didn't give you the latest one.
Okay.
No, I think this one's probably the later one.
Okay.
Yeah, she's got it.
Oh, thanks.
Thank you, Diane.
Thank you.
Yeah, because this is.
Yeah. Okay.
I've got it.
Oh, you got it? Okay.
All right, so final.
So we have to show how things come in and they come in differently.
Right.
And they cover different paths because of that.
Mm-hmm.
Three types of things: criminal, officer-involved shooting, and serious use of force go from us to IA. If we get them, they go from us to IA.
Right, and that's right
okay?
here.
And so it's the feeder system, and then it breaks off from there. So mm-hmm. That's how we have to show it, and we're not doing that.
Well, except that I would argue that complaints that come to us with potential criminal allegations flow this the way this indicates. But the officer-involved shootings and serious use of force do not come to us.
No.
In the beginning.
No. Those come to us through IA.
Right. So right. That's why I'm proposing that be a different box over here.
And so this piece of that comes to us, it goes
exactly.
into here,
exactly.
and then comes to us.
Right, exactly. And we're proposing, instead of APD, IA, which makes that more clear.
Okay, give me a chance, and give me the That's weekend, and I'll come back to you with something, and then we can discuss that. But I would like to put the two pieces together.
That's fine. I just have a couple more comments for you to consider. On the bottom where it says findings letter with appeal info and it has an arrow to the chief, I wonder if that arrow should go to chain of command or where does that actually go?
I think we talked about that.
Yeah, we did.
Yeah, I think it's
does it go back through IA or does it go through the chain of command or does it go through to the chief?
I think that this is actually repetitive because your discussion and vote is the letter that goes to the chain of command.
Okay, so then what I would recommend.
So then I think that this box should just simply be moved straight below because this is what the citizen receives.
And that's the point I want to make is that there's no indication that the letter is going to the complainant.
Right, right. So this, I think, if we moved it over and had it be a straight flow from POB.
Right.
And then that's the information that goes to the citizen.
Right.
The findings letter
and the appeal.
And the appeal information.
Absolutely. Perfect.
And then it goes to the chief.
That is a
or
separate.
Or does it go to the chain of command?
Both. It actually goes both.
Okay. What this one is here.
Right.
I think.
Right.
Or not this one.
The discussion and the vote.
Right. Okay. That makes that more clear.
Goes to the chain of command.
It goes to this.
Right.
Yep. Just put it with this, and that goes to the citizen. It goes to the chain of command of the police.
Right. I agree. I think that's good. Okay.
Doesn't the internal affairs put their stuff to, isn't there an arrow here?
Where?
Here. Between IA and the chain of command.
Well, that's what I was asking, was where this information really goes, because I don't think it goes back to IA. I think it goes to the chain of command at this point. Is that right?
Well, if it flows properly, then our review, and then it goes to the chain of command. So that's the urgency for the officer-involved shooting case at this point.
But wouldn't the officer-involved shooting, that's what this whole block is. So
right.
That goes to internal affairs.
Right.
That has to then go to the chain of command.
It has not been to the chain of command yet.
Right.
Who has it gone to?
Us.
Us?
Internal affairs has completed their investigation. And
And is that what's supposed to happen?
And
it goes to us and then to the chain of command?
Yes.
So IA doesn't communicate with their own chain of command? That's crazy.
Not as it relates to
investigation.
Findings.
Right. Because their IA's role is the investigators. And once the investigation is done, their role is done. So the investigation then goes to the chain of command. So in other words...
Well, that's what I'm saying. It doesn't say that it goes to the chain of command.
Right, but it doesn't come from IA. It comes from us, which is what this is right here. So we get it at the same time the chain of command gets it, I'm presuming, which is why they want the file back, right? So they can start their review process.
Right.
Yeah.
Right, we're actually getting it before them.
Right.
Are we talking about officer-involved shootings?
Yes.
Any of them.
In this case,
right?
Yes.
Okay. I may call you with some questions.
Of course.
Okay. I think we're much closer.
I might pick up the phone.
Joanne, it's Joanne.
Yeah, he's got you blocked, I can tell.
Yeah, he's got my number.
Any more discussion on the flowchart? I'm going to have my pencil.
Let me get a pen.
I think we're getting closer.
I think we're almost there.
You know, it's weird because some of this seems so apparent.
Right.
Like that findings letter should have been right there.
And that's why I describe it as madness, because you can see it in your head and transcribing it into pen and paper is just really...
But we have to.
Absolutely.
We have to really pursue it, because otherwise we're not going to make... This isn't going to make sense to the public.
It doesn't make sense to us. When we present it, we're going to present it as a leaning room.
Yes.
At the what?
My circle...
We're going to present it at what?
Down.
At Thursday?
As a linear instead of the circle.
Oh, okay, yeah. Are we going to... Do you want it for Thursday? Or do you want to wait? I want to wait.
Yeah.
I want to make sure we got it right.
Yeah.
Okay, there we go.
Thursday's going to be pretty...
Yeah, rough.
Interesting.
Okay, moving on. Director Harness, your report is next on the agenda.
What do I have to report?
Cases.
We, as a staff, met, and we are in the process of doing, as we discussed at the last CRC, I'm reviewing the cases. We have our first case that went over to the ADR.
What's ADR?
Alternative dispute resolution section to hopefully mediate the complaint as opposed to it becoming an investigation. So we've sent our first case over there for mediation. The other complaints are in the preview process, and they're going to be assigned to the investigators on Friday for the rest of the cases that we have in, as we try to get in a rhythm with the monthly meetings to try and make it easier for all of this to fit within those timelines. So we're going to give that a shot. And then if we get pushback from the DOJ, we get pushback. We did receive feedback from the Department of Justice as to the cases that they reviewed as a part of their review process.
What cases?
When DOJ was in town last time, they took a time period, a time frame, and then they randomly chose cases to review out of that time frame. And we sent them the information.
From us.
From us.
Our cases.
Yes. And Dan Giaquinto, who's essentially our DOJ team monitor, who's works most with our paragraphs, sent back his feedback regarding the investigations. A couple of things that we could improve on are following up on and documenting witnesses within the cases. If witnesses were developed as a part of the investigation or were named in the complaint, documenting why there wasn't any information from those witnesses, if they weren't available, why not? Or if they were, why weren't they interviewed? A lot of cases where the investigation was timely, but the review was not timely. And I believe that's the result of the previous director sitting on the cases and not moving them forward. Other than that, the reviews I thought were very positive. Did point out that we need to also concentrate on our role of advising our policy and procedure for cases as they come up. So, you know, is there a training opportunity here? Is there a policy recommendation as a result of this type of investigation?
A lot of that's going to depend on once you get your statistical person.
Yeah.
And that'll give us a lot of data to where we can have input it, strategically input things that we need to.
I hear what you're saying, though, and I like the fact that in the IA complaint that we're going to talk about, you produce some policy and procedure issues.
Recommendations and
training. Yeah, I think that's what they're talking about. In these cases, in the cases individually, if we recognize.
Conceptually, right? I mean, I don't think that it's proper for us to say, okay, here's this investigation and here's this big long policy that we want.
No, right.
I think, as Dr. Brown has pointed out, that we should be talking about these in conceptually.
Right.
And based upon, because we have these incidents, which are an opportunity to evaluate activities and perhaps impact them.
Right.
And so I think that's what they're saying, and that certainly was my thoughts as I mapped out some of the things that I saw as possible changes and things that need to be considered as a result of that IA case.
I think that's good input.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we should probably have that input on Thursday, too.
Well, it's part of the draft letter at this point, so.
Yeah.
Okay. The draft letter to whom?
Well, I mean,
to the individual.
To
here.
When it goes. Okay. Yeah. To that, in that case. Yeah. But right. I mean, in terms of the, were you talking about the feedback we got from DOJ?
Yeah.
Not just that letter, but I mean the feedback we got from DOJ should be part of your director's report.
Yeah, can you make that
sure? Sure, then I can. The DOJ review. There's about 20 of them.
I have something that's related to this that I want to bring up, and maybe this isn't the right time, but. Tell me no, but let me bring it up and we can table it to later if you want. It seems to me that I keep noodling back and forth on this. How are we going to bring the public with us? And I think that it comes down to we have to show them. And Leonard and I went to a meeting with APD Forward. And it was clear that they're not getting, I mean, we already have a sense that from this committee that, and I think the board, that the camera is the officer's best friend, you know, that's clear. And we were able to share with them that, you know, anecdotally, that there are people who believe because it's the worst event of their life, you know, that something happened. And when you look at the video, that isn't what happened. And it's emotionally charged. And so unless we have a way to share that going forward, for people to be able to read it, then we're not telling the story. We're not bringing them with us. And that bothers me. As a storyteller, that's bad, as far as I'm concerned. So, but I also thought when we were talking about, I don't really want to post up those letters with people's names and addresses on them either. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't think that's right. You know, we don't have the officer's name, but we have the complainant's name mm-hmm. and address. I don't like that. So I think the findings of the letter itself, including the complaint and everything that follows, and I did one, I took one of the cases and I did it as an example. And I took the, I found and replaced the person's name with Mr. D instead of whatever the guy's name mm-hmm. was. And so if we say case number and the date it was filed, and then after I did this, I thought it actually should say presented to Police Oversight Board on this date and it was approved. So I mean, that actually hasn't happened with this one, but to put that up there. And then That's one thing to do. That's one thing to say, here's all the cases that we dealt with this month. The other way to look at that is to say, is to cluster them as examples of issues we're seeing frequency on. And maybe we do that once we have the data analyst person in place. But to say rudeness, let's say, as an example, is one of, there's a host of those things that was rude. And either the officer was rude or the officer wasn't rude and it was found that they were exonerated. So to me, to organize them in some kind of way, futuristically, looking into the future. In the meantime, I think we just need to post up the things we have done, the cases we have done. And I would feel better if we didn't put any identifying information on the victim. We have the case number, and if somebody wants that and it's, open records, whatever, then they can get it. But I don't want to post that on the website. I just want to bring people with us as we go on this journey. Because if we don't, all of this, we're just another secretive group that people don't get answers from. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Right. And so to me, if we're gonna change the trust issues, we're gonna have to tell these stories.
I think from the standpoint of doing that, probably be easier than what we do now, where Marlo has to sit and go through a complaint and then draft the synopsis, instead of simply having the letter, the findings, doing a replace on the name and then being able to post it. That would probably be easier.
So this is my example. And that I did, and so I would just say to you that I think that this part here at the end should be over here. It should be right here.
Well, or we could attach them as the part of the minutes.
Well, I think it's too hard to find. Because I don't know about you, but reading minutes is killing me, and I don't even want, and I am involved in this.
Okay.
So I think that...
Well, so, we can set up a separate category on the... In our linear.
I think we have findings.
Page. Okay.
I think we have findings, and
we can set up a. You want to set up a. So, do you want to set up a separate findings link?
Yes.
Within our menu.
Within our menu on the board
on the website.
On the website, yeah.
Okay.
And so I don't know if you want to see that, but that's was my idea. And because you're talking about cases and what gets disclosed and whatever, that's why I brought it up. So to my way of thinking, the work that goes into this is so important, and I would just assume, when we talk about it at the board meeting, a thumbnail is a good idea, but people have to be able to look, read the whole thing. And I think the work is really, there's also some stuff up when we go through the cases, I'll tell you about. There's somebody who's writing these complaints, this findings, and they start the story in the middle.
I agree with you.
And they have to remember that it's not just, the investigators have to remember, or whoever's writing this needs to remember, that it isn't just the person who's getting this letter, right, who knows what happened, but it's a public document. And mm-hmm. So they have to do that. And I'll tell you when we get to those which ones I think they are. I have a feeling it's somebody's writing style, mm-hmm. and it just needs to be more clear to them.
I know exactly what you're talking about.
So you have, do you have more? Do you have
what else? Case management software. I spent Thursday with the IA Pro developer, and we're continuing to transition away from the Cirrus software, which we use now, to the IA Pro software. He's made some changes, and one of the changes that he made was to delineate your board's findings as a case result, and to put in the concurrence and non-concurrence with the department.
Good.
So he worked on that back end, and that is going to be available in the new version 7, which IT is going to have soon, and within probably the next 3 to 4 weeks, we should have it uploaded on our machines.
Good.
I don't know that it's going to have everything that we need, but it's certainly going to get us much closer.
Which brings up another point, and we'll maybe talk about it in the cases, but it seems to me that when we have a disparity between findings, like the chief's letters, when we post that, we need to show that this is what we said and this is what they said. And, you know, even if we do nothing else besides that, we have to be able to show the public that we disagreed and how. And that's, they're all public records, so it's fine. Again, I think that the victim's name should not be in there. But I'm just saying that that disparity has to be obvious.
And that's a good way to do it. Because we really had no obvious avenue to do it otherwise.
The only other thing is, what are the dates, Diane? Hmm? Training?
In March.
March.
21st, I think.
2 days?
Two and a half days.
The investigators are going to be going to Los Lunas for use of force training.
Good.
So that will be coming up in March.
Good.
I will have the budget numbers for the board. I just went quarterly, had our quarterly meeting, so I have those for you. And the contract for your legal team is in the pipeline, getting all the approvals.
Good.
Can I go back to the mediation?
Mm-hmm.
Who is that organization? Who does the mediation?
There's the city attorney's ADR section. It's a division of the city of Albuquerque. Ty Hummel is the head of that division, and his assistant, Shannon Kipling. They have a staff, a cadre of mediators that they have contracted. They do mediation, so usually Ty and another contracted mediator conduct the mediation. They do all of the logistics of setting up the mediation, contacting the parties, and conducting the session.
So the people who during the mediation are not city employees?
They are not.
Okay. And a case, give me an example of somebody, of what would go to mediation?
Well, I mean, there's the checkoff box on the form that says, are you willing to mediate this?
Okay.
So that obviously would be one of the first considerations. And it really, at this point, is kind of my judgment call as to whether or not I think that a mediation
could be helpful
in this case. Nothing with use of force, obviously nothing criminal, nothing that's going to go over to IA.
But it's an administrative complaint that could be mediated.
Certainly. Rudeness, traffic, and some of the maybe some of the things that are older. That brings up a point. So the case that we just sent over there is a case of an individual that complained about his interaction with the department. And rudeness and his treatment. The officers were named. I contacted the officers. I sent them a copy of the guide, APD mediation guide that Paul and I have put together. So they have an idea of what to expect as far as the mediation. And I contacted the complainant, and the complainant was still willing to mediate. Once I have those in place, then I simply alert the ADR section and they take care of the logistics and they update me with the progress.
So you're not there?
No.
When that happens. Okay.
No.
But that is not knowing that would have been helpful. And if I knew that, when we talked about the family that, you know, where the cops came and they were looking for, so I had a legitimate reason, but it was all, you know, guns open and stuff like that. And maybe that's an opportunity for, we talked about how would you do that, and from a PR standpoint, would that be smart on the part of the police department to like say, we understand that you're upset, but we had cause to do what we did. Mm-hmm. And maybe that's a good place to put that, is to say.
I would agree. It would give mm-hmm. them a chance to explain their perspective. And in a non-threatening, neutral environment, and then they can share with the department how they felt as a part of that interaction.
Right.
And once
and the police can get to say, right, we had cause, this is what we knew at the time.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So would you see us, in a case like that, as part of our suggestion as far as the quote-unquote discipline, is that it's not sustained or exonerated, but that we would recommend mediation because of X, Y, and Z?
Well, you know, I think that in the letter we sent to that family, you know, just to say that the officers had a right to do what they did, it might be neat to add a paragraph that said, if you know this, we understand that this is another option. You can appeal it. You can also have an opportunity.
Ideally, we would have offered them the mediation
before.
Prior to.
Okay.
Prior to the whole investigation process.
Okay. So that's something the investigators could do in the conversation with
them. No, that's what I do. That's okay. What I do, because I'm reviewing every complaint as it comes in for its suitability.
But at the time you do that, you don't know that what the police did was exonerated or not.
True. Well, it depends on how well the complaint is written. It wouldn't. I'm sure the ADR section would not be opposed to offering it post finding either.
It's just such a dramatic event in somebody's life.
The ADR section they're very excited to be involved in this process now.
One of the cases we have here is for today is, you know, a mother who was with her son and it was ATF that was doing, they were trying to find her other son.
Mm-hmm.
Remember that case?
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, it was 10 minutes of hell for everybody, you know, because they thought the son that she was with was somebody who was wanted. You know, it stinks to be her. Because she has a son that's
like,
in...
Or to look like your brother.
Yeah, to look like your brother, exactly. You know, but that's another opportunity to say you need to understand going forward that, you know, this could happen again. It could, you know.
One thing to consider is if the mediation that we're discussing post-finding were to be successful, is we'd have to get a buy-in from the department. And I'm not sure how we would do that, because basically if we say, Officer so-and-so, we find your conduct to be exonerated, but we want you to go to mediation. That's going to have to be something the department encourages, because otherwise the officer is going to say, if I didn't do anything wrong, why do I?
It may be outside of our bailiwick, but I think it would be smart on the part of the department.
Well, I agree, and I think we could perhaps facilitate that by encouraging them to be part of that. We'd have to make inroads somewhere.
Because
otherwise the department's going to say, well, if we did nothing wrong,
Ty would be very instrumental in meeting with the powers that be that would try to put that kind of process in place.
That's good.
And it's probably something that could be as simple as we have this case that kind of fits this profile. And if Ty and the chain of command have some agreement in place like they have with us,
right,
then they can try and facilitate it.
Right. But what I'm saying is we should try and make that happen, because nobody else is going to.
Okay.
Please.
I'll talk to Ty.
Perfect. Thank you.
Well, and it may not necessarily have to be the officers who are there. Maybe it's somebody...
Yeah, it could
be
anybody.
Their supervisor could be anybody, you know, that's related to the case, but not necessarily the officers, so that they don't have to feel like, I mean, they've already been exonerated.
That's
but
a good
it's
point.
A department saying, you know, sometimes we have to do things that scare people, and, you know, we're sorry that happened to you, but it was still necessary, you know.
The sad part is that should be happening at the time. There should be a supervisor, especially in the case that you're discussing, a supervisor should have been present and should have done that debriefing with the family at the time and probably saved the whole mess.
Yeah, well.
But.
Yeah, okay.
Okay.
Anything else,
sir?
we need to examine whether or not there's the ability within the settlement agreement for us to establish some sort of limitation on
time.
Statute of limitations.
I have that on some of the cases here. You know, that's just ridiculous. 2 years later, somebody files a complaint. That's nice.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
And so I think that some have previously interpreted that the language says that we have to take any complaint at any point in time.
Right.
But I think that we could probably set some sort of a reasonable limitation to say, if your complaint is from 2010, I'm sorry, we just can't investigate that. There's no good that's going to come from that.
Well, you're going to end up with brick wall after brick wall.
Right.
And half the time the cops are no longer cops.
Right.
But that would require some amendment to the ordinance as well.
Well, I think we should
explore I'm not sure that it would. I mean, and if so, then maybe we need to explore it.
Because I'm pretty sure the ordinance is specific about the fact that there is no time limit.
Maybe there's another way, and that is to say, before we embark on this path, complainant, you know, there's a lot of time that's gone by. The chances are good that we're not going to end up with anything that's, you know, that you can sink your teeth into, for lack of a better word. And, you know, do you really want to go ahead with this? I mean, kind of thing. Because, I mean, they may be pissed at the moment. And it's also, it seems to me that there are some of these are CIT.
Yes, absolutely. That's what, that's the
that's
majority
who's doing
of
it.
Them.
Yeah.
Yes,
so, I mean, to me,
they're in an episode. And they're in an episode, and this is their reaching out and expressing frustrations, angers, all of those things. And so these things come into mind. And I mean, I have 6 complaints that came in from the same person.
Butters?
I don't know the name.
Baker is one another.
I don't know the name. But they're all older. And they came in through internal affairs, so they have a number, so the time, the clock is ticking on.
Oh.
But I mean, I don't see anything that is going to be accomplished that we could do with any of them.
Well, I think the CIT is the answer to that.
Right.
I
and
do think
Dr. Baca and I were discussing how we could intervene in these cases where they're coming in. But I think that's a fine balance to say this is a CIT issue and not really shouldn't be a complaint that's being investigated.
Yeah, I agree.
I
think one of the things that's tied to that, in my opinion, reading these things, is it's confusing to me why somebody who complains, you know, so often about the same thing, and it's always found not to be justified because it's something in their head that they think is justified but isn't objectively justified. I don't know why there isn't a policy that says CIT goes out on those calls, period. You know, I don't know why that person isn't red flagged to make sure it's CIT, because that's who can help them, you know, or can deal with them and better trained to do that. Otherwise, you know, it seems to me in every area command there's got to be people that do that. And what's the systemic way that they're approaching that, and perhaps that's a recommendation we can make.
So would we, as the receiver of the complaints, then make the CIT referral?
Well, I think that there needs to be something with CIT needs to be red flagged and saying, you know, we don't have anything, we have no expectation that there's anything different in this complaint in the last 6, you know. And rather than waste everybody's resources, let's do something else.
Some of the complainants, there is enough of a relationship where our investigators do reach out to their caregivers, and that's how it's been handled informally. So some of that is happening.
I think that we need a way to deal with frequent flyers,
mm-hmm.
period. You know, on both sides, you know. And if we are successful in our mission here, we will end up with that. This is just one of them.
Mm-hmm.
I agree.
You know, I would say that there's, you've gotten, I've read in the time that we've been reviewing cases, I've read 3 complaints from somebody who comes to our meetings all the time. And in every case, they're not justified. Okay?
Right.
And, you know, you spend time and energy, you know, doing that. You know, I expect we're not going to change that one.
Right.
But I think that, you know, the amount of resources you put towards that is not going to be the same as something else. It's crazy. You know, how can you more efficiently deal with that? I don't know. When he doesn't have a CIT officer, you know, assigned to him.
Right.
But at least with those that do have a CIT officer, you know, there's something else you can do. There's another resource to bring to bear.
Right.
So, and maybe their caregivers should talk to their doctors and stuff like that, you know.
Well, some of them, we do have the caregiver's information, so we can reach out to them when we get a complaint when they're in
crisis.
When they're in crisis and they're, and this is the manifestation of it.
Well, I'm suggesting that in that case, unless there's something really that's real you can follow.
Right. No, those cases don't go through the full investigative process.
Well, but unless there's something you can actually follow, then I think the course of action is to call the CIT officer and say she's at it again or whatever it is. And, mm-hmm. you know, she's in crisis. You shouldn't be dealing with people in crisis.
No.
That's not what this is about.
Right.
There's people whose job that is. You know, and there's, you know, the other thing is that there's human services beyond what CIT has. And so I'm sure they work closely with some of the providers, but there may be more than they know about. There may be more avenues than that we can make sure they know about. Especially you and I can tell them some of the people that we deal with.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe check to see what their list is, because the CIT officer isn't the living end.
Right.
They can't spend a week with them.
But you know, I think getting Dr. Baca involved in this and her connection with the mental health program that she's involved with is a good idea, because she would probably have some clear ideas on how to get the CIT backed up and what the next step would be beyond that, because she's been going to the mental health review.
Well, it begs the question that should we take a look at what kind of resources CIT has outside of the police department? And is there a way to get more information to them about it, to see whether or not they have all the resources they could have? They may have just some favorites and not all the resources.
Yeah.
So
that's
it would
true.
Be worth it to check.
Okay.
I mean, offer a helping hand. So.
Okay, anything else?
No.
Okay, so next we move on to the agenda item 7, review of cases. Now, the way I see it, we have 3 different things to talk about here. We have the 25 cases that we've all reviewed. We have the new officer-involved shooting case, and then we have a discussion in general about that we've tried to tackle last time and didn't really get anywhere, but I think it's on point because now we have an example of what we talked about last time. So the order of those is up in the air. Does anybody have any suggestions?
I want to do the officer-involved shooting one first. It's going to be first on our agenda for the board, too. So I think we should do that one. And then I want to do the chief letters.
I would like to have the discussion about, continue discussion about the topic that we started last meeting, and that was, how are we going to handle this situation? Remember, you talked about we needed to find out where it needed to get fixed and fix it so that the timing and everything, because essentially what we've got is a situation where we've got an officer-involved shooting that has not been signed off by the district attorney. So, you know, the union raised this giant cloud of us tainting juries and having this, overwhelming impact on the public and that kind of thing. On the other hand, we have an administrative role. It's an administrative investigation, and should we just do what we are, directed to do, and let everything else fall?
So then the way to start that conversation to me is to say, where you got this officer-involved shooting case from IA?
I did.
Okay. So.
Friday.
Okay, and we have till when to get back to them?
Wednesday.
tomorrow.
Okay, and are we to bring this to the our board? I don't know how we can give you feedback without having it be the whole board.
Wait a minute, is Wednesday the 30 day?
No, Wednesday is Wednesday is fitting it within the time frame so that the chain of command has a chance to review it.
Okay, so the file just has to go back.
For the full 30 days, right?
We don't have to
file has to go back. No, there's no, the file has to go back to IA Wednesday.
But we have until when to have findings?
Well,
30 days.
I'm not sure exactly when the 30 days expires, but if you're going to do it, it needs to be considered by the board on Thursday. Mm-hmm. I have a call into the district attorney's office to district attorney Brandenburg to confer with her whether or not the board moving forward with this in an open forum, whether she believes it would hinder the criminal investigation as it relates to her office. I have not heard back from her yet.
If I might interject, we really need to push that because that's one of my top concerns. Because I don't want that to happen, if that's the case.
So the solution, with or without her call, she's a personal friend, I can call her and she will call me back. So we can make that happen today.
Please.
Okay.
The thing that I think is important is that we comment and give that feedback to the police department. It doesn't necessarily mean that's when we give it to the public. You'll have the board together and we could still do it in closed session because of the concerns about the DA and all of that. It's possible. All I'm saying is that's one option. Mm-hmm. I don't understand, but it's possible. So having been set up with this before,
right.
I will tell you that my concern is if we do something to make the case worse to prosecute, that may be playing into the hands of people that want it to be worse
exactly.
to prosecute. So I want to make sure we're not doing that.
Right.
And so if calling Carrie is the way to get to the answer to this question, then let's, after this meeting, you and I just call her and find out where we are with this.
Okay. I left a message for her. She was in a meeting along with the other attorney that is involved in their officer-involved shooting team, Attorney Davis. They are both in the same meeting with Burlingame County Sheriffs.
And this is one of the reasons I really wanted Mark here was because I don't think we can do this discussion in closed session.
Right, we can.
Why can't we?
Because it's not personnel or litigation related.
It is litigation, not with us, but
no.
It's litigation.
I believe that it would have to be in an open session.
Absolutely.
I don't believe that it can be in a closed session.
Absolutely. And that's the problem. And that's what the...
Okay. Well, let's just get through the agenda today.
You brought me in for one of the reasons you brought me in is because I'm from out of the loop here. Mm-hmm. And in my mind, I can't conceptualize how an administrative hearing that's going through its processes as it's supposed to under city ordinance can sway a district attorney's decision on what the district attorney believes are the criminal charges that could be brought in a case, especially a year removed. This incident happened a year ago.
Most of the information's in the paper.
I understand that previously that this is how it's happened here in Albuquerque, and that certain factions believe that because things are out in the public domain, that influences the district attorney's decisions. I understand that's the position of some people, but your policies and procedures say that we should check to make sure that this is not going to interfere. However, you have the right by a two-thirds vote to say we're still going to move forward.
Well, and I agree with you, but on a practical
Common sense. That's common sense.
Personal note.
Yeah.
I would be horrified. I'm very torn because I would be horrified if we were to impact the prosecution of this case in any way, whether it be through influence on the DA, whether it be some type of error that the defense could use, whether it be, you know, because this is huge in my opinion. This is the match that the public's waiting for, is to say, finally, blah, 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 blah. And that is a concern. On the other hand, I really, really, really want to have input, if nothing less than to put the chief on the hot seat to say, for the Civilian Oversight Committee to say, we have these findings, and if in fact they disagree, to make them explain why. That's the heart of the oversight process, in my opinion. So I'm at a loss, but
so it's not a question of if we're going to do it, but when.
Well, it's not really a question of when, because if you're going to have that,
well, that's true.
If you're going to have that input,
that's
then
true.
It has to be Thursday.
That's true.
Otherwise, you're outside of the 30-day review period, and then therefore there won't be any discipline. There won't be any disciplinary recommendation as it comes from this board.
That's right.
It may still come from the chain of command, because they're going to make a ruling and they're going to make a finding.
Right.
But if the board is going to have input, it's going to have to be Thursday.
And this circles us back to the argument, the discussion we were having last week about it's set up to fail. And now we've got a concrete example of that.
Well, yeah.
And we don't have time to fix the problem, and we need to make a decision on how to move forward. But I would very, very much value the input from the district attorney before we were to make any kind of decision.
Well, we have it on the agenda so that we can act on it if it comes to it.
Which was a good call, though.
If it's not there and the board doesn't want to move forward for fear of impacting, then simply the board can table it. I'm done with my review, I think. I don't know that there's anything more that I'm going to contribute to that draft letter. So, I'll await your guidance.
Okay. So how do we do this? How do we find out what the district attorney said?
I'm texting her right now, so I will call her, but I didn't want to interrupt the meeting, but I do want to text her and see if she calls me. I'm taking the call.
Yeah.
So, I'm sure she's busy with Manny Gonzalez this morning and pepper sprays and whatever.
Oh, yeah.
But I'll go over to her office. Come with me.
I think it's going to have a lot to do with what she says.
I agree.
So, before we make any decision,
I agree.
Before we adjourn this meeting, let's call her together. Let's just do that.
Okay.
My understanding was that the review was to be completed by the end of February. That's what the union's understanding is.
But okay. It's a year. Didn't you just say it's a year?
Yes.
So how did we get to 30 days all of a sudden? That's hard and fast when it's a year ago.
Because there was a criminal investigation relating to this file.
Right.
The fact that there's a criminal element of it allows for the suspension of the administrative review timeline.
And in fact, my understanding is they don't even pull the IA number until that's done.
Right. So once the criminal is completed, then you're back to your administrative timelines.
Right.
So that's how we get to a 30-day review period timeline in this instance.
Okay. All right, so I'm going to suggest then that
let's go through the letters.
We go through the other letters first. And let me start by saying, in defense of Director Harness, I realize you had nothing to do with these letters, but I would like to make the overall comment that some of these are so absolutely horribly written, they don't even make any sense. So I would encourage moving forward that these letters be composed in a way that makes more sense and is just not. Some of the stuff in here is just crazy. And I'll make two points real quick and then I'll turn over to the floor to Member Fine. One of the ones that I made note on was 060-15, and I'll just read the first paragraph under the complaint says, Mr. N, wrote Officer C, approached him and blocked his way. Mr. N wrote Officer C and asked him why he was there. And I think this is one of the things you were talking about. We have no idea what's going on, where they're at, that kind of thing. So even though it becomes clear down in the body of the letter, it needs to start out with Mr. N was...
This is so consistent on some of the letters that I think it's the same person that's writing them. Okay. So I wrote notes on each one where there was, you know, that it was incomplete.
Right.
And that's what how I called it, that the complaint, the letter was incomplete because it didn't start from the beginning.
Right.
But let's go in order if you, because that's the order in which I have them.
Okay.
Is that okay? You have a second one?
Are these cases then that are still on the jump drive?
Yes.
Okay. Yes, they're the next 25 of greater than 120 days.
Okay.
3515 would be the first one, right?
No. 04315 is the first one.
Oh, how did I got? Okay. Then I counted wrong. Okay. Let me see what number is the other one I want to talk about. We can just go in order, and when we get to the one, I'm...
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, so the first one, 04315, I agreed with it. It's, do you want me to
I agreed with it.
You got it?
Yeah.
Okay. Let me go back to the next one. This is the Martinez letter, 04415.
Yep.
I agreed, but see note. Okay, so... there we go. I think it's just a typo. Oh, the officer's name is in there. And if you do a search for Detective Padilla, you're going to find his name spelled out. That was the mistake I saw. So,
okay. And then what number was that? I'm sorry.
4315 is
it? 04415.
04415.
The next letter is the Hague letter, and that was just agreed. I agreed with it, and that number is 04515.
I agreed.
Yes.
Leonard?
Yes.
You good? Mm-hmm. Next one's the Birch letter, 04615. This is, there's confusing language. Just a second, let me get down to where it is. On this letter, it's on page 3. It says, computer-assisted dispatch report for the incident on March 13, 2015 showed that Mr. Birch did not call the police to complain about a dog and neighbor problem, as Ms. Birch wrote in her complaint. The report showed that Mr. Birch called the police. Mr. Birch told the police he was calling on behalf of his wife. The whole thing is confusing. Here's the case. The case is that the wife is a little is lost. She's got some illness. She's dying. She calls and says that it's about the dog and the neighbor. And when they get there, it's about the son stole stuff from them. Mm-hmm. So this woman has issues, and the husband's trying to mediate between the wife and the police officer. The poor police officer doesn't know what's up. So, you know, I would say that it's confusing how it's written in terms of explaining that they called for one thing and they said something
else.
Seems
like something a few words just got left out of there for a descriptor.
Yeah, it just doesn't make sense. So, but the other thing is, since there have been numerous calls for service, is a CIT an appropriate recommendation? Because they list the number of, the investigator lists the number of the dates of all the calls. There's a lot of them. And I just think that there needs to be something else is happening here, and it's not going to go away. There needs to be help for that family.
So I guess the question is, how would the officer get all those dates unless he's the same person?
No, she said that somebody else had come out to accept the complaint, and that she'd been complained filed several complaints.
Right, right, that's what it is.
Or called several times to the police department to get the same thing.
Yeah.
The dog and the neighbor, but it's the son, you know? I mean, this, I don't envy the person who has to deal with trying to sort out that kind of chaos. Does that make sense?
Yep, makes sense.
Okay, McCarthy letter. C notes. I agree with the letter.
Which number?
I'm sorry.
04715.
04715.
I agreed.
But there's some confusing, so it says on the complaint, Ms. McCarthy told Detective M, Alfred Baca, Robert Bartley's drug deal and the drug dealer and the homeowner who shot, there's a word missing. It should say, Ms. McCarthy told Detective M that Alfred Baca, Robert Bartley's drug dealer and the homeowner who shot, whatever, but it makes it, there's too many names in a row without a break. And so it's, that sentence needs to be clarified with the word that. Okay? And there's another one too. At the end, let's see where we are. We're on page 3 again. It said, it talks about the person said that the that things were not, personal items were not returned. There's in that sentence, it says that's what she's complaining about, but it says in the letter, regardless in a homicide investigation, personal items would not be returned because they are considered evidence. But there is no finding about that complaint. There's no statement that says, you know, unfounded or exonerated or whatever it is. It doesn't say anything. All the rest of the letter has findings. But for that complaint about not getting her stuff back, it explains why she didn't, but it doesn't have a finding. And I don't know if that's intentional.
Okay.
Does that make sense? Okay, Zion letter, 05115. Agreed, no notes.
Agreed.
Nodal, N-O-D-A-L, 05315. Agreed, no notes.
Mm-hmm. I agree, but I have a note.
Okay.
And I just want to make sure everyone's on the same page, because there's a statement made in here that really, really knocked me out. The statement reads, Officer W, during the incident, did use profanity in her speech in an attempt to use verbal control over Ms. Nodal. I would argue that the fact that she used profanity in her speech indicates exactly the opposite, and that she had lost control. Using profanity never, ever, ever is used to control. Raising your voice.
Is this the fire one?
Yes.
And so the woman was swearing at the officer
right.
the whole time. And she was the one that was really off her beam. But you're saying...
Well, the officer swore back.
Yeah.
And just putting a statement like that is just...
Is a flame.
Yeah. I mean, it's completely ridiculous.
Well, I will tell you that in the review of the cases that came back from the Department of Justice and Dan Giaquinto, he would disagree with that opinion.
Well, and this is.
I'm just saying that's what that's in. And we just had a lengthy discussion about this. Based upon that review last Friday with all of our investigators about the fact that the SOP says no profanity.
Right.
That's it. There's no, there is no room. It's shall not.
Right.
I'm not sure why that descriptive paragraph is in there, and because that doesn't follow what the SOP says.
Right.
But in the review from the DOJ, the DOJ wanted to know, well, what was the context of that language and was it appropriate? And from our position, that the SOP says it's never appropriate. So that's why there's always going to be a finding, even
right.
though the DOJ says maybe you shouldn't have found a violation in this case.
And this is the huge can of worms that we just opened. And I'd be very, very interested to see what Beth's perspective is on this. Because I would like to see any evidence of police training that encourages the use of profanity to gain control over a suspect. Because
it's
that's the
control
only
issue that you have. It's not the word. It's saying that that was a way of her getting control.
I think it's the opposite.
I agree. It's the
language. You're saying it is the opposite. It's not control.
Exactly. It's loss of control.
So it's the control word. It's not the swear word. It's how it says that it was a way to get control.
Mm-hmm. Right.
When that, how is that, you know, how is swearing?
Because in all my training and all my work, that is a clear sign of loss of control on the part of the officer, because it doesn't accomplish anything except escalating the situation.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So, like I say, I'd be very interested to hear what Beth has to say.
I could understand how someone could get to that place, but saying that it's a way to get control is wrong.
Right.
Does that make sense? It's not the swearing part.
Yes.
But that's trying to justify it by saying something that, like that, is disagreeable to me. Like I say, this is part of what I'm getting concerned about, because I wonder about the training that's being done today, and whether that's contributing greatly. Because I, in kind of a nostalgic overview, I look back on my 12 years, and I think, you know, we didn't shoot anybody, and we didn't have these problems, and a lot of it was, I think, partly because the people I worked with were mostly ex-military, and they had a sense of discipline and self-control and that kind of thing, as opposed to what one of my friends describes as the Pepsi generation that came after me. But I wonder about the training, because during the Citizen Police Academy, when the homicide sergeant showed us that scenario out at the truck stop, I totally disagree with the way that was handled, and yet she totally thought it was appropriate. So I just wonder, if somebody wants me to believe that that's a legitimate statement, I'd have to see some training. But I had a real problem with that.
I don't think you're going to see training. That's not going to
happen. Exactly.
Yeah.
Now, it's interesting that the DOJ would argue, well, maybe that's not a finding.
I think the difference is whether or not it's a control. That's the difference. It's not the swearing. The swearing, you can have a finding on the swearing saying that was it's against policy.
And that might be the part that the DOJ is looking at.
We
use profanity and...
Yeah, but it's not our job to say what the SOP should be.
Right.
It's our job to say what the SOP is.
Right.
But his issue is not with the swearing. It's with saying the swearing was part of getting the situation
part of the swearing was reasonable.
Which part of a tactic for gaining control.
Right. And it's not reasonable. It's a violation of the SOP. So I'm done with that. Thank you.
Well, you need to say whether or not you, I don't know, this is the first time that we've disagreed with each other about
I'm not disagreeing with the finding. Because they sustained the...
Just change that language is what we're saying. That's the control language. Is that what you're saying?
I'm not... I guess what I was saying was in the future, because...
Well, if you don't want your name on it, honey, that says control...
Well, I really don't, but... So I would maybe eliminate that. Or edit that sentence, because it really does bother me.
Yeah.
And like I say, I agree. They sustained the findings, and I'm fine with that. But to try and justify it, it's like, well, it was wrong, but it was okay because this is what she was trying to do.
Yeah.
It's just at odds. I mean, it doesn't make sense.
Okay. Are we ready to go to the next
one? Yes.
Okay, so 3514, Nijinsky. I'm
35
sorry.
Or 53?
I'm sorry. It says 3514 on the letter. Ted, it's Ted's. Mm-hmm. Mr.
It's 15715.
No, there's a second one.
Oh, there is.
This is the first one.
0606.
Let me go back to the file name.
06015 Nijinsky.
The letter and the number on the file don't match.
Oh, okay.
So it's 53-14.
Okay, that's what I have. Okay.
Okay.
So the letter doesn't match the number on the letter is not the same. And I agreed with your findings and no notes.
I agree.
Okay. I mean, I'm looking at the letter, and the letter has the 060-15 one.
Well, that may be the
second
one.
That's a different.
One.
Okay.
That's a different one.
Okay.
Yeah, we're going to get to that one.
Yeah.
That's
that one's coming.
That one's
okay.
coming.
So then, all right,
the,
so
5314 is what I have.
5314.
5314 has the wrong number.
Correct.
Okay.
And this next letter is 05615, and it's Alicia Silva. And agreed, no notes.
Agreed.
Agreed.
Zero 05814, Tutar. Murad Tutar. Agreed, no notes.
Agreed.
Rojas 05815. Agreed, no notes.
Agreed.
Carrillo 06014. Agreed, no notes.
Agreed.
Leonard, are you with us?
Yes, trying.
Okay, now we're back to two again, 06015.
Yeah, that's.
Agreed, no notes. Oh, C notes, wait a second.
Well, that's the one that starts in the middle.
Yeah. Yeah, and so that's the same thing. So it says, it starts off, Mr. Nowitzki wrote, Officer C approached him and blocked his way in the parking lot. And I put in the parking lot of the Old Baptist Church, because that's what happened that I found out later in the letter. So injecting where in there
at
least gives us what was the event, what was happening. And it doesn't, so it's just not clear. And later when I was reviewing some of these and came across something like this, I said it was incomplete. Because it's just hard to understand what's going on. It starts in the middle.
Right.
Carrillo, there's another Carrillo letter, 06114. And so this is the husband and the wife each complained
right.
in separate complaints, but it's about the same thing.
Right.
And so I wondered, I agree with it, but why not put both complaints together? Is there a law that says that?
No, we will do that in the future. It was the previous director's belief that those should be separate complaints. And the DOJ comment on that is that they should be considered
together.
As one complaint together.
Agreed.
Okay. Yeah, I agree with that.
I agree.
With that. Anderson, 06315. Okay. There's a typo in it, so I'll tell you what that is first. Just a second. It's on page 2, and it says it's after SOP 2-082 in the after the statement of that. It says, additionally, as a field training officer. It's just a grammatical error. It says, as an field training officer, so that needs to be changed. But my main thing was, look at the dates. Look at the dates, May 6th and March 14th. 2015 is when they filed, and it was from 2013.
Yeah.
So it begs the question of how long between event and complaint. And I think there needs to be some accommodation to that. Anyway, that's my thoughts on that one.
We concur with that.
it's a waste of energy, you know. Zamora letter 06314.
That's the other.
That's the other confusing
right.
one. and the confusing part comes, wait a second. After on page 2, the fourth paragraph down, it says the contractor, the contract investigator. And I thought, I don't know who that is. I have no idea who the contract investigator contacted APG records supervisor. It's very confusing.
Yeah, it's a function of the fact that the investigation was done by the outside contractor, and our internal investigator actually wrote up the draft letter.
Okay, so if you're going to name somebody, you have to say who they are, because we're not the only ones going to read this. So the contract investigator needs to be explained in some fashion. It's mentioned twice.
Or the other option is to not differentiate in the letter.
Yeah,
just say
it doesn't matter.
Right.
You know, it's our finding.
Right.
So
whether they were contracted or not is irrelevant.
Zamora, is that the one I just did? No, Anderson was the one I just did, right?
Zamora's the one you just did.
Yeah.
Zamora. Okay, so this is confusing also. And I wrote a note to my, that's the one we just did. That's the contract, yeah. So that was Zamora. Orozco, 06515. It's also an incomplete report. And it's incomplete because it's the complaint starts, Miss Orozco wrote, Miss Hernandez attacked her and injured her. What happened? Who was dispatched and why? What transpired? We're in the middle of this. Yeah. We're not starting from the beginning. Why was the officer dispatched in the first place? It may be clear to the investigator, but it's not clear to me and it won't be clear to the public. Laney letter, and this is 06715.
Can I interrupt you just a second?
Sure.
Going back to the one we were just talking about, it occurs to me that there's some duplication of information in those letters because it starts out halfway through under the complaint, and then in the body of the investigation, it starts at the beginning and then kind of duplicates this the part that we just read in the complaint.
Yeah.
So maybe it could all be done.
Yeah.
Maybe it could be done just once and not, you know, in other words, if under the complaint the body of the story is listed, then the investigation could refer back to that and it might save some.
Okay.
And that's just back to the way, I mean, just for your edification, that was the way we were all told to do it that way.
We all disagree with that.
Yeah, we all
think there's a better way.
It doesn't make sense to me.
That's not our choice, but that was
your choice.
So.
You
can
figure that
out. Yeah. Okay, thank you.
I'm very happy to say refer to.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because, I mean,
it's too easy.
It's redundant. It's just. It's like you already told me this part,
but
it would have
lawyer speak,
been nice
and
to know.
It's the thing that makes people angry.
Right.
So.
Okay, I'm sorry. Thank you.
Okay, so it says that there's not enough information for findings, so it's administratively closed, right? Yeah.
Which one was that? I'm sorry. 6515?
6715.
Okay.
Laney. Agreed on Brooke, 06815.
Agreed.
Mm-hmm. And I think, is that the end? It's just a few more. Okay. Griffith letter, 06914. Agreed.
Agreed.
Dixon, 07115. Agreed, no notes. Anderson, is this the same Anderson? 07215. This same thing. Time lapse and consolidation of complaints. As the time lapse is from the complaint is May. It's from March 14th, 2013, and the complaint is filed in May of 15.
Yeah.
You know, so it's also a consolidation of the complaints, you know, and a time lapse issue. I think we need to have the board address that, and I don't know that case review is the way to do it, maybe it is, but that we need to bring this issue of time lapse to the board and have a discussion about whether or not that's smart.
Yeah, I've got it here as a note for my report, so I can speak of it as a future board discussion.
Okay.
Okay. Butters, here's another frequent flyer. It has incomplete, my notes are incomplete, no context, frequent flyer, but each letter needs to stand on its own. So I think that the issue, if I remember correctly from this complainant, is that she files complaints at different times, but it's still about the same thing.
Oh.
And and it starts in the middle. The complaint says, Mrs. Butters wrote that Officer S. never asked her to provide details about the rape and sexual abuse she suffered. You can't start there. You
yeah.
have to start
exactly.
from what was called, what was out. You know, it should reference, if you're going to do it in separate letters, it should reference those other ones as well. There should be a cross-reference to those things. Otherwise, it's really hard to follow, so I would say that's incomplete. Gallardo 07415, agreed, no notes.
Agreed.
Do you agree?
I started at the wrong place, so I didn't get this far.
Okay, 07615, excuse me, agreed, no notes. Leonard, are you?
I agree. Martinez is my last one.
No, I have Wolf. I counted to Wolf. Oh, Wolf, maybe one of the other ones, just a second. Did I say 07615 already?
Yes.
Okay. Gonzalez, 07915. Okay, this, here's what my notes say. Way too long. Agree with the findings, but no need to go into all of the back and forth conversations. Summarize it and move on.
Yeah.
It's got every dialogue, every, it's nuts the way it's written. So yeah, I don't know who wrote it, but it's.
It's long.
It's he said, she said, you know, crazy.
I think that this one was written in with the DOJ review in mind. As the audience, as opposed to?
It doesn't work.
Okay.
08015, incomplete report, started in the beginning, redo it. it says, Ms. Martinez reported that Officer E immediately had a biased attitude against her. What? You know, so it's, I believe it's somebody who's started, they're so familiar with the case, they are trying to get to the point and they're missing the point.
Well, I think what you're illustrating and what we need to do a better job of is they're essentially putting the complaint here as we got the complaint. This is what the complaint says. This officer was immediately biased against me, and that might be the complaint. So what?
That must be what it says.
That's what that's what the complaint actually says.
And that goes back to what Diane was saying about the style.
Yeah, I mean, we were told to summarize the written summarize the written complaint. So when you're seeing that, that's what the written complaint said. Then we're summarizing the interview from the complaint, and that's what we were instructed to do. So that's that's why you're seeing that.
With no context. Doesn't
make any sense. Well, but that's what we were instructed, is summarize the complaint, summarize the interview, and then jump into your findings. So that's basically what you're seeing on these older ones, especially,
right.
Is that we were summarizing what we were given, and then we go into the actual, findings and all that.
I think there should be a different way to do it.
Yeah, we can put the complaint into context so that
you're telling a story.
So that,
here.
Right.
You got to start in front of the story.
Right. So that we can, and I'm very much about everything being linear.
Right. I agree.
So my write-up of the events for the internal affairs complaint is completely the opposite of the way it was set up from internal affairs.
Mm-hmm.
Because I thought that That seemed to me to be the logical train of the event, so that you could follow it all the way along,
well,
as opposed to.
I couldn't agree with you more.
I agree.
This is storytelling.
Right.
And it is about getting clear on what it is. The fact that, however, the police department does it may be work for them.
Right.
Doesn't make it work for the complainant and doesn't make it work for the public.
Right.
So we have to tell stories because that's what we have.
Well, I even like the way that you discussed the events, and when you got to a point where part of the complaint alleges a violation, you went into that and explained that, and then had a finding. And then it said, and then blah, 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 and you stopped when you got to the next alleged violation of an SOP and explained that. That was very easy to read and understand. Mm-hmm. So that by the time I got to the end, I was done.
Thank you. That was my goal.
Yeah.
And that we're going to evolve. This is right. Not to be seen as critique for its own sake. It really is about making it a better story and easier to understand.
Yeah, and so yeah, we're all on board. With,
yeah, okay.
Yeah.
All right. So Austin Wolf, CPC 08115.
Jeez,
I have.
Yeah, really. I don't have any.
What?
How many did you do?
25. It's, I say that I agree, but how did he know it was Officer B? So here's a guy who's speeding. He says that Officer B tailgated vehicles and cut off another vehicle. Mr. Wolf wrote that Officer B sped up and did all this stuff. And it says it's not sustained. I want to know if this guy never had an actual encounter with him. How did he know it was Officer B?
Gave him the car number and they looked it up.
Yeah.
Okay, it's.
It doesn't say that.
I agree with it, but it's confusing to me that, you know. Yeah. And it wasn't he the guy that actually was the one that was racing the car? He was the one the cop was pursuing him? Is this that one?
No, I don't think so.
I think he was just.
This is flipping him off. Yeah. This is the flip off guy. Is this the flip off guy? See, flipped him off. It says in the letter, it says, you know.
I know. It says right out there.
Is this the one? Anyway, I just wondered how did he know it was Officer B?
Flip off guy. Agreed, flip off.
Don't do any drawings, though.
Okay.
That's all
okay.
I had.
So this is the case summary, which I gave you. And then this is the dead dog one. This is the one you put in the Freeman.
Right.
Do you want to hold that for another day?
Yeah, because I didn't read that one.
Okay. I didn't read it either.
But could you look?
It's an exoneration, so it's there's not going to be any.
Okay.
That comes from
still it. Didn't read it.
What question? Do you have questions that you want me to answer for you?
No, I just think it shouldn't be in that file. I think that what the ones that you can archive the ones that we've already done by the date we've done, and so that maybe you're doing that now, and I just didn't understand it. But
right.
It seems to me that the cases we get. If it says less than 120 days and more than 20 days, then everything needs to be out of there that we've already decided on. You're saying that is.
It is. So
I didn't realize that.
That SharePoint file that's less than 120 days are all new cases that you have not seen.
Got it.
Okay, so could someone enlighten me as to the number of the case I'm supposed to start with for next time?
Well, probably we need to add Freeman. Or add the people on that less than 120 days.
Those cases are on the agenda.
For
Thursday?
For the POB, yes, they are.
All of them?
We didn't deal with
them. The SharePoint cases, yes.
We didn't deal with them today.
No, we dealt with them the last.
The last meeting we had.
Oh, those are those.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
I don't recall that you did. But there are new ones in there.
No, we didn't deal with
it.
We did everything.
I don't think you dealt with. I don't think you dealt with these that were in the SharePoint. There's. Let me pull it up. There's.
I thought the ones that were in general.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
So did I.
There are 9 cases in there. There are. That does not include the internal affairs case. All of the cases in there are unfounded or exonerated except for 184-15.
But did we review those?
No.
Okay.
So the cases that are listed on the Thursday agenda are the cases we saw already?
They're the cases that you've done for these 25, and then they
And the 25 before?
No, these aren't on the agenda. It should only be the 25 we did last meeting, right?
Right.
Okay, I'm confused. If we are going to have Thursday have cases we haven't seen, then I have a problem.
Right, this group here
will go in March.
We'll go in March.
We'll go in, should go in March.
Okay,
so the first group that we did should be
at our last CRC meeting.
Should be in the CRC.
Let's pull up the agenda just to make sure.
Here's the list of the ones we did that I thought should be on the agenda.
Exactly.
Let's pull up the agenda that, so that.
I don't have the agenda, but I have the minutes.
I can pull it up.
Which shows the ones that you went over.
We have to make sure that the minutes, I mean, that the minutes and the agenda are the same.
So the ones we, and the minutes are these here.
Yeah.
Exactly, 41-15, right.
-15. This. 041-15.
Right.
Those are the ones that we need to go back and put on.
Okay, so those are on the POB agenda for this coming Thursday.
Exactly.
Right. That's right.
But nothing else, other than the IA case. I just had the agenda.
Actually, but there are these other nine cases that are in the one
that we just went over?
No, that are in the SharePoint. So that are the under 120.
Yeah, we can't.
Yeah, that are on the agenda.
We didn't see them yet. We can't make recommendations to the board because we haven't seen them yet.
Okay, well, there's a case there that involves an internal affairs investigation where I've made a finding and a recommendation on discipline in it. And otherwise, you're going to be outside of your order. 30-day review period.
Okay, that's the part that's confusing. So, is it just that one case that you feel like we have to do on Thursday? And is it on the agenda?
It's on the agenda, and it's in the SharePoint there for everyone to review.
What's the number?
184-15.
Okay, all we knew is that we were going to do the next 25 in all greater than 120 days.
Okay.
We didn't
you were going to continue to work on the over 120 cases.
Yeah, but.
But that there was the ongoing less than 120 day cases that need to be a part of the constant review because otherwise
that's
you
fine
are going
as
to expire.
Of now, but I
was
going to
say
gonna be on the agenda for the board.
Okay.
So otherwise we would have dealt with them today.
Right.
Okay.
It's nine cases. Maybe we can use them today. I don't know.
The only case that has any findings is the internal affairs case and the 184-15. All of the other cases are exonerated or unfounded.
So, yeah,
The synopsis of the 184-5 case is that there was an allegation of criminality, so it was investigated by internal affairs. The internal affairs investigation was completed and found that there was no criminal violation. There were administrative violations for failure to tag evidence properly. And the two officers were sustained for doing that. I reviewed I reviewed it and I sustained as well. And based upon their disciplinary history and the recommendations in the chart of sanctions, I recommended a written reprimand for both officers.
I'm good with that.
I'd still feel better if I could read it. Is there a way that I can read it right here, right now?
Sure.
Can you get on SharePoint?
I don't know how to get on Wi-Fi here.
It's the COA file. Sure, I can pull it.
Would you check the agenda to make sure that we have the right numbers?
Well, I'm looking at it now. And it doesn't look like it.
No, it's definitely not right because we've got 201, 205, that's 222.
Do we have 00215? It's on there. 00012-15?
Yes.
So it's kind of confusing because we've got.
Yeah, that's.
Well, he's got those 9 other cases mixed in.
Yeah.
Oh, you just use your finger.
On the screen?
On the screen,
I
yeah.
You want to see this?
Essentially what happens is they make an arrest, the officer pulls out the wallet of the woman who's arrested, gets her ID, and forgets that he puts it on the top of his squad car, and he drives off. He goes and finds it a couple of hours later on Coors. He picks it up, inventories it. When he goes to inventory it, the electronic tagging system is down, so he can't do it. So he's told, instructed by his sergeant, to do it when he comes back for his next shift. His next shift is the next day. He forgets to do it. He goes out on calls, and it's in his trunk. So the sergeant reminds him that he needed to tag it and bring it in. So he's there. He and the officer, the one officer who left it on the roof, and the other officer who failed to tag it into evidence, are found to have violated the evidence.
Did she get her stuff back? Or did it disappear?
She was alleging that there was $750 in the
wallet. Oh, yeah,
wallet.
Sure there was. Of course there was.
Which is why you don't take the wallet. You
which
have
it by the lapel video, you can't see that there's any currency in the wallet. And she does not actually file a complaint initially. She simply is asking how she can get her money back and why it took long for the evidence to be tagged in. But they do initiate a complaint in, and they do an investigation. She's very inconsistent with her. She's interviewed multiple times. She's very inconsistent with her statements. But she is referred to risk management if she wants to file a claim. And that would be how she could recover her money.
Mm-hmm. But see, this is another example. I don't know what they're telling these guys. You don't take a person's wallet for exactly that reason. You make them produce their identification, and that's all you handle. You don't take a wallet and start fishing stuff out.
But if they're arresting her, she can't keep her wallet.
No, but it's inventoried at booking, not in the field.
Right. Yeah.
You leave everything the way it is, mm-hmm. and when you get to booking, let booking inventory, because they're taking custody.
The officer shouldn't have conducted it that way.
Right.
Because the officer actually, she's in handcuffs, and she produces her wallet out of her sweatpants.
Yeah.
And then he gets the ID, and instead of giving it back to her and having her put it back in her pocket,
right.
he sets it up on her car.
Right. That's why you don't handle
right.
that stuff.
Right.
It scares me. One of these poor guys don't know.
Okay, so.
So it's unfounded in terms of that she's saying he stole the money, and it's unfounded because.
There's no evidence on here.
No, it says unfounded regarding, which means the investigation term by clear and convincing evidence that it didn't happen. How come? If you don't have it.
Oh, should it be not sustained?
No, I think it's clear enough that the money wasn't there.
Okay. Based upon the
money wasn't there in the first place.
Right.
Oh, okay, the video.
Right.
Okay, I buy that.
Because if you go not sustained, then you've got an officer who's being accused of theft, and you're saying that just by a preponderance of the evidence.
That it's
yes or no.
Yeah, I mean, if you've seen the video, I trust that.
So is this an opportunity for training? And does it say anything about their history?
No, it's my review of their disciplinary history, and then.
But it doesn't say in here.
Well, you can't. What we can do is infer that by the level of discipline recommended,
that
it's not a problem.
Right. It's a first violation, level 6, which requires a written reprimand.
Well, where does it say that's your recommendation?
It's in bold.
Okay. It's first offense, level six, I see it. Okay.
So with regard to the
agenda,
at some point, so how are we going to handle that? Are we going to hear or consider those cases Thursday or not?
What were the instructions the board got in terms of reviewing cases?
Was I supposed to review the new ones as well?
Well, that was my understanding, that was how we were going to be moving forward.
Well, do we have the agenda? Can we look at that?
I've got it right here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31.
I hate this. This will work so far, but this shit. So it's 25.
Plus
which would
be 9,
seven
should be
more. 25. If it's the 25 that we did.
Which it looks like it is.
Here's the first 25. Starts with 00215.
Right, to 04115.
Yeah, 04115. Is that what's on there, on the agenda?
Well, it's mixed up, so.
No, it goes across. The way they do it, it goes across.
It's still mixed up.
Yeah,
it's
still.
I shouldn't say mixed up, it's not ordered the way.
So do you want me to set up the agenda as these 25, the older cases are going to be on the consent agenda, and then there's going to be, and then delineate the newer cases that are going to be reviewed? Because
well,
right now they're all.
What we're saying is we haven't reviewed the newer cases.
Okay.
So.
And they could be on the consent agenda, we just don't know. Right. Let's see what the board, what was the instruction to the board? Because I don't.
Well, it's about what we published, too, because we don't want to be in violation of that.
Well, except that just because we published it doesn't mean we have to hear it. I just wonder what everybody else has been looking at.
Yeah.
Because if we're the only three there, dark, maybe we could just get them done.
Well, we can do the other nine, but I don't know if our first 25 from the over 120 days, and the nine is the same either as the ones that were put on there. So I don't know.
Well, there's only 31 cases on the agenda, so it can't be the same.
I don't know. I need to see the list of the ones that are on the agenda. Do you have that?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Michelle, where are you?
I don't see the notice to the employee.
I don't either.
I said one day bring.
Yeah. I responded, by the way. Yeah. I said, I totally agree with you, Dave. If you'll look, it says it's a consent agenda.
Do you have it in front of you?
I don't see where we.
How can I not find it yet?
I don't see where we asked them to review the
new ones.
Yeah, the new ones.
How can I do that?
Ed, you sent out an email morning. Please review the first 25 cases on your jump drive and the folder 114.16, more than 120, starting at 00215 to 0415. These cases will be on the consent agenda in the next quarter.
That's what we have. That's what we go with then.
Yeah.
Okay.
Because that's what they're instructed to do, but the agenda is confusing.
Well, here it is.
The agenda is incorrect.
Well, we'll amend the agenda, and
we just have to explain that we, you know, I just think that if anybody wanted to see it,
yeah, I agree.
Yeah, here that's on here.
Just,
01414.
Go with what we told everybody.
I think they're just in a different order.
Yeah, they are. But there's more on the agenda that's in that 25.
Okay.
Well, let's just deal with the ones that are on here.
Okay.
Is there, and this one, and is there a time, a time problem with this 18415?
Yes, and I think we should.
And is that the one we just read?
Yes.
Okay, so let's just agree to that one and
right.
explain that to the board.
Right, and the fact that IA sustained it the same way we did, the only difference being is the proposal level of discipline. So
right,
and then we have to.
And that's probably what they'll do anyway if they follow the.
Right, but this is your. This is a case that fits all. Everything fits within the timelines.
Right,
and it is your. It is your first opportunity with a mandate to say that this is what we believe the discipline should be.
And that's fine.
That's good.
It's going to be, that's the way it's going to work from now on.
Right.
You know, so it's okay. You know, one of the bad things about it is the timeline. We're going to have issues with that. We know that.
It's always going to be a conflict.
It's going to be a conflict.
Yeah, always going to be a conflict.
Okay.
So what did we decide?
We're gonna
do the first 25 like we thought we were gonna do.
On the consent.
Because that's really what's on that list.
And then on the
anyway,
agenda,
it should be a
we do
order
have
for some reason.
There's the internal affairs case, and then 184-15.
Okay, so let's talk about 184-15 first. What are we gonna do?
Let's say we agree with it.
But none of the board will have seen it, right?
It's available. It's on SharePoint.
Right, but they didn't know to look at it.
Well, I mean,
we can explain it to them.
We can tell them that they've got till now, from now to Thursday, to look at it and be prepared
okay.
for the meeting.
Mm-hmm. If you'll send that email out,
sure.
Okay. And you can say that the complaint review committee believes it should be part of the consent agenda
to meet the timeline.
I don't know. I don't think it should be a part of the consent agenda. I think it should be
separate.
Okay.
Like we did.
And we're going
like
to have to do
last,
that with the chief's letters, too.
Like we did the last meeting, where we have the current cases that were
I think that's
being
where
considered.
We have this on the agenda, too. Right?
I got it. 184.15. No, it's in the
group. Well, that's okay. It's on there, so.
Right.
We can move it.
You just pull that one out.
Yeah, just pull that one out. And we can do that during the approval of the mm-hmm. agenda.
Mm-hmm. Right.
I'll make a motion. Okay.
I'll second it. We'll
cool.
be all set.
Right. But if you would send out the email to have them review that one.
I will.
Please.
Because
it's not a long one, apparently. I mean, I only have to consider one more.
And then you want to remove 22215. You don't want that dog shooting case.
Well, they didn't get a chance to read it
okay.
at all. So I'm sure the board didn't read it.
Okay.
But I think that our next agenda for this committee has got to be the next 25 and everything that's in the SharePoint, the share thing.
Okay.
That is less than 120 days.
Okay, so again, I go back to my original question, and that is, can somebody tell me what case we're starting with for the next 25 for next time?
Oh, yeah. Just a second. I can.
Because I started in the wrong place and came up short.
No. It starts at 08515.
So that's the start.
That's the first one.
Plus 20.
It's Cunningham.
Plus 24 more.
Plus 24 more.
Okay.
Okay, I'm going to try calling again.
Okay, I'm going to take 5.
Yeah, let's see if I can get her on the phone. Right now, the phone is busy.
Check and see if this is the message, if she left me this message.
It is.
phone number. She was returning my call.
Let's call her.
Who was the call? Who was she answering?
Whose phone was she answering?
Yeah.
It looks like her cell number. Oh, thank you, buddy.
Yes, Attorney Brandenburg, please. It's Edward Harness from the Albuquerque Civilian Police Oversight Agency. I'm returning your call.
We see it. Okay.
Instructions for the Wi-Fi are behind the TV.
Yeah, you just pull up the COA free. Yes. Okay, thank you. Yes, Attorney Brandenburg, Edward Harness from Civilian Police Oversight. How are you? I'm calling. I'm not sure if you've been appraised of the situation regarding the internal affairs investigation into Lieutenant Brocco. Okay, well, under the Police Oversight Board's rules and regulations, for the Police Oversight Board to review this, they want to ensure that their review at a public forum will not jeopardize your criminal investigation into the case. So, can you say that? So it's your opinion.
I can't hear.
I hear you. Well, it doesn't matter what. I understand what you are saying as far as the perceptions and what you may hear or may not hear, but the Garrity exclusion would not allow you to use that in the first place, whether you hear it or not. So if that in fact makes it confidential and not usable. So I hear what you're saying. And I hear you saying that you would prefer that this board not act because you don't want to be influenced. I hear that, okay? But my understanding, not coming from this jurisdiction and not having been here for, you know, maybe 120 days or so, I came from Wisconsin. This is an administrative hearing and it should have no impact on any criminal investigation that your agency is conducting. And that would be my position. I understand what your position is. So your position that I will relay on to this subcommittee and to the board is that you would prefer that this board not act on this.
Yeah, she needs to know the consequences.
Not, okay. Attorney, I'm not going to argue with you about your staffing and how you do your workflow, and whether or not officer-involved shootings are a priority in your office, and you have other things to do. But in this case, this is a timing issue for this board to act under the ordinance and under its public charge to review this case, so that if in fact the board decides that there should be discipline instilled, that this is what should happen, and this is why the public sat this board, and that's why the city council put them in place. Okay, someone can come up to you and say something that's hearsay. That's not going to be anything that's admissible, and your duty as the district attorney is to bring a case if you have probable cause. How would that influence you from an evidentiary standpoint? I am a lawyer. Appearance of affecting. What legal standard is that? What evidentiary standard is that? How does an administrative hearing lend itself to an appearance of a conflict of interest for a district attorney charged under the criminal code? That's correct.
She can stop it. That's all.
I have done the review, and there is no direct statement in part of the review as it relates to the findings. The statements are not made public. As a matter of fact, his identity isn't made public, although that's here nor there at this point, based upon the publicity of this case. It would be on Thursday. You know, I'm trying to be very respectful here of you and your position, and I understand that you feel like you're being put in a trick bag here with the processes that are in place. But I think to simply say, fall back, do what you're gonna do, and if something happens where I can't prosecute, oh well, I'm not sure how that.
got a lot to say.
Regardless of what she says, this is what we need to do. We called her, we asked her.
Oh, I agree.
Okay, well, I appreciate your time, and I appreciate your input, and I will take your input to the board and so that they can make an informed decision. Okay, I thank you.
Well, that was.
Did you summarize?
That wasn't her best foot forward, was it? So explain what happened. She thinks what?
You're on camera too.
You should, I just want to know, do you think that the gist of what we could hear from this conversation is she's not sure how what we decide will affect her case, and we go ahead at our own risk?
She has no idea how or if it could affect the case. She would, in a perfect world, prefer that no action be taken until her review is completed.
Of course.
Their reviews of these cases are their secondary job, because they have their other full-time job that they do, and these officer-involved shootings are what they do in their spare time based upon their staffing. So that's why there's such...
That's crazy.
That's why there's such a backlog. She does not... She is concerned about the appearance of impropriety and an appearance of conflict of interest. She does not want to stand in the way of us doing what we have to do. She understands that we have to do what we have to do, and she will do what she has to do if it involves some fallout based upon the recommendations of the board.
Okay, so here's what I suggest we do. We recap before we present this case to the board on Thursday. I'm telling you that I think we should present it so that we can do the thing we were tasked to do, which is to say we recommend this discipline, we recommend this training, and this is our findings. So I think that we should do that. We should precede this by saying we have a concern about this timing and its effect on the process moving forward. But if we don't respond now, we lose the opportunity to do our job. And therefore, we are proceeding. And it is our hope that this is not used for whatever purposes to change the outcome of this case, or the prosecutability of this case. And we did our due diligence to call her, and this is what the advice she gave us. Are you okay with that? I just am sick of everybody saying you got to dance to this tune, you got to dance to that tune, you got to do. We have to dance to the ordinance tune.
And that's why I say, that's why I commented earlier that we were at a huge fork in the road, because based on what you just described, her position as far as these are, you know, busy work types of reviews, we're going to keep bumping into this over and over and over. So.
Well, it's not the second job for us. It's the first job for us.
And so we need to decide where we're going to go. What do you think?
I agree. Okay. I'm all on board. And best after this conversation, I didn't hear a whole lot of it, but
I'm convinced even more after speaking with the district attorney to move forward.
One of the things
I don't get it. I don't get it.
One of the things we got to continue to understand is we don't answer to anyone.
And
we dance to our own. Okay. City council is our.
We're beholden to the ordinance.
And the ordinance is our guide.
And the citizens of Albuquerque.
And the citizens of Albuquerque. So.
I think we just need to say that we realize that there are conflicting and timelines for everybody, and that we're not in charge of that. And we can't not do our job in order to meet someone else's timeline. So we are doing our job. And this is what our findings are. And it is our hope that it does not negatively impact the ability to prosecute or not. It is what it is. We're just saying what we're saying, period.
So
I'll
what I'll do.
Because that's bullshit as far as I'm
concerned. What I'll do is, don't write that down.
Don't take that one.
Sure, I'll give you a call and maybe I can draft something
And what I'll do is during, does my report come before?
The cases, no.
Cases?
Why wouldn't his report come before the cases?
Because it's grouped as.
Yeah, but it's crazy to have all the cases and then, I guess we talk about the overarching issues when you give your report, not the actual.
Well, what I was gonna suggest is, because we have this, we started this discussion in the last meeting, which is what I'm gonna report on. I could kind of lay the groundwork for where we, how we got to where we are, and then you can.
So.
Make a comment about where we.
This is how it's decided in your policies and procedures.
And so, I mean, I think it's, I also would submit that it's a board decision as well.
I think you have to take a vote.
Yeah, I agree.
Director Harness says.
But we also need to talk about the chief's letters and.
Guys, I have to go, I have to meet somebody as well.
Okay, all right, but I, here's what I'd like to see, I have a suggestion. If you would take the letter that you wrote to the people that we already, we've already decided on these cases, correct?
Yes.
Okay, so if you take that letter and what our findings were and where the, and compare the, what the chief found differently, I would like to present that to the board. That makes it public record and at least we're telling a story. I gotta go too, buddy, I gotta, I have a tooth that needs to be pulled. How fun.
Where are we at? That was my agenda. Do we need to figure out when we're gonna meet next?
Here. Next, yeah, review of cases, we have to vote, she's right. I make a motion that we proceed on the letters as we commented on them, as amended.
Second.
That we approve the letters as amended.
Okay.
Okay, motion is that we approve the letters as amended, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay. Next meeting, we have a date?
This is gonna come pretty quick.
Tell me.
22nd looks.
Be the 23rd if you want.
I'm gonna be in Florida, I'm not gonna be here till the 26th.
23rd, LA.
FLA, that's me. So for 10 days.
10 o'clock?
What time? The 23rd, you're gonna do it anyway?
Oh, you wanna cancel?
No, she's not gonna be here.
I'm gonna be in Florida.
So what we would be reviewing would be the next 24 cases, 25 cases.
And the new ones.
And the new ones.
The less than 20, 120.
Are you okay with that if we?
Yeah, I can send you, I can send it to you. I can tell you my comments on all of them.
Okay, that'll work.
That'll work.
So the 23rd, is that the right date?
Yeah, and that way it kind of keeps us on track.
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay. All right.
And is the cutoff for the new cases today or before that day? As of the day before, the 23rd?
New cases?
Yeah.
Yeah, because he's gonna put them on SharePoint, so there's nine there now. There could be another nine.
Could be another nine, yeah, today.
Today's good, yeah. Okay.
As of today?
As of today.
Okay.
All right, I'd entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Adjourned, thank you folks. So.
Joanne seconded.
Do I not?
You seconded motion to adjourn.
I did.
She did.
And I voted aye. I cracked this guy up. I know I cracked you.
Hey, I need to talk to you real quick before you get out of here.
I will.